All right. So good afternoon, folks. If you all are okay with it, I'm not going to use the microphone because I'm known for being a little louder. I know, hard to believe. So first and foremost, I want to start off by level setting. If you came here for an amazing demonstration of Cisco's networking technology, you'll be very bored here today. Our intent in working with the AFCEA team is to sit down with transitioning men and women and provide some coaching and guidance based on what we've seen as you all make a transition from military service, either as a civilian or a serviceman or woman, into the private sector. If you're looking for something else today, I welcome you to stop by our group. We've got some really smart folks. Most of them are sitting up here today to hear me talk this afternoon. But what I don't want to do is have you sit through this expecting the silver bullet as to the future of NetCom or how Cisco is going to solve all the networking problems in the world. Not what we're going to talk about today. My name is Jason Fort. I do have what I consider one of the greatest jobs on the planet. I get to work with Cisco and lead our Army practice here at Cisco here in the United States and over in the Middle East, Africa, and Asia. But in all candor, I grew up as a National Guard E7, and when I made that transition out after deployment, trying to figure out what I was going to do next. Surprisingly, 11 Charlie indirect fire infantry mortarmen did not translate well in the civilian sector, right? I didn't know what to do. And I knew that I wanted to change in my career, but I didn't know quite how to get there. I also grew up at a time when the dot-com boom was going on, and I figured out how to program HTML, and I figured out how to do some Visual Basic, and I figured out how to lie enough to get my first programming job. And then I realized I really hated programming, and I wound up in project management because those who can do, those who can't manage, right? And I wound up managing, and I really like that stuff. But I got really lucky, both in being born in 1970 as the dot-com boom was coming to fruition, my career was kicking off. And I got lucky because I tripped into a couple of jobs. As I look at this, it's now our duty, I believe, as industry to give back, to kind of coach and mentor and help folks that are making that transition, give you all some lessons learned, and walk you through what has worked for us, and open my team up to you all to help coach and mentor and make that transition even easier. In my spare time at Cisco, I've got the opportunity to lead 3,000 men and women who are veterans of the United States Armed Services and their spouses, and we do a ton of outreach all over the country, and I love that about my company, right? There are very few places on earth that can say that this is the kind of work that we do when we're not doing the work that we do, right? I got to spend some time this year with a few of my cohorts here rebuilding the USO at Meyer Henderson Hall. We do an annual training and all these sorts of goodness. I tell you this because after you walk out of here today, I want you to LinkedIn connect with me. All right, I'm begging you, Jason Fort, out of Annapolis, Maryland, Baltimore area. Find me, and I will help you use my network to improve your odds of making that transition happen. With me today, I've got Gus Mendiola. He's going to step up in a minute and introduce himself. We'll be co-presenting because y'all don't want to hear me talk all that long. And we've built out this content in partnership with a company called RiseSmart. They are one of the sister companies of Monster.com, and they do this sort of stuff worldwide. So I knew that the messaging that we were going to portray today, I could come up with a lot of it, but I'm not the smartest guy. And so I piggybacked off of what these guys have done, and we've got some handouts toward the end that we'll share with you guys. So with all that being said, if you want to leave because this isn't the session you thought, now's a good time, sit down, Frankie. All right? And know that I'm going to be picking on some of you throughout the course of the day. All right, so again, I sort of covered down the welcome, pretty straightforward. So, you know, as we looked at this thing, we have something called the brand. How many of y'all are familiar with Walt Disney World? I'm going to take your families out there. All right, so sir, in the blue shirt there, when you think about Walt Disney World, what do you think about? Give me some adjectives that come to mind. So I told you what to think on y'all.
Family.
Yeah, family, right? Big family thing. I used to joke with my mother, who was a bit disturbed, that if a kid ever gets abducted in Disney World, no longer the happiest place on earth, right? It's a safe, family place to worry about there. What else do you think about? Starting back in the, what do you think? When you think of Disney? No, you start with the, you're going to look at haircut.
That's
your goal.
It's not
Vayner.
Oh,
I'm sorry,
it's our Vayner. I'm just being called Sir. I don't know about inflated revenues over the last 3 years, or
that's just
not
the case. No, I mean, it's huge, right? They're a profit-making company, right?
Other than that, it's always been like,
right, so having a vacation. These are the things that we think about when we think about with the brand. What we looked at is that if we go forward and make our transition happen, there's what's our brand look like? And if you guys have it every single day in your careers, right, if somebody thinks about you and says, hey, what are the adjectives that they use to describe you? This is a little bit about what we're going to talk about today. Now, you think it's kind of corny, but as a hiring manager, when somebody shows up to me and I say, tell me about what you want to do with the rest of your life, and they say, well, you know, I'm really looking to get a new job. That's not your brand. That's not who you are. It's not what you're going to do for me as a hiring manager. Right? I want to get you a career, but most importantly, I got a need to fill. And if your whole brand is based around you want a job, that only gets you so far, right? So as we looked at this problem set, we wanted to kind of identify how do we help you all develop that brand, because as you build your social network, as you build out those relationships, this is the part you got to lead with, right? Every day I get a LinkedIn request from some dude or dudette that's around the world, right? And that's where it goes, right? And I say, accept, fine. I got a new friend. Interesting. But you had an opportunity there for a minute to reach out to somebody that's in the industry that you want to work in and make that connection. I've accepted it, so clearly I'm really bored on the internet. I've seen every other page on the web, so I'll take a minute and hit the accept button. And now all of a sudden, I'm looking at this and I'm going, all right, this person's reached out to me, especially you guys in the green suit, right? Y'all are in my profession, right? You're my target audience, and if I can help one of you guys out, I'm going to win some hearts and minds as part of that. You're going to tell your friend about what a great company Cisco is because this dude helped you out. I'm in. You have my attention the second your VA photo showed up there with your social security number on the bottom of it, right? Tell me I'm lying, right?
He's not wrong.
Right? But you got that moment, that precious moment. This is where I want to know about your brand. I want to know about who you are, what makes you who you are, what makes you special, right? Even the most introverted cat I know has got some unique value propositions that other people don't bring to the table. So we wanted to spend a little bit of time with you all today, talk a little bit about the brand, and as we wrap up, we're definitely going to be talking some more about how you go about connecting with companies like Cisco, connecting with Cisco, doing all these good things. So I'm going to build this one out. I just like ducks. So as we look at this, we want to start out by defining what our strengths are. All right. The one thing I've known from my experience working with soldiers and actually military folks from all branches is that we are the most humble cats out there. Right? Thank you for your service, all. Right? How many of you guys have been there? Sitting in Burger King? Come on, man. Right. Hey, you're a hero. I'm a hero. Right? I don't know. Y'all are pretty cool. So my point is, as you go about this exercise, what we want to do is identify what those strengths are and set that humility aside. Okay? So I hope within the first 2 minutes of this conversation, you sort of start to figure out what my brand is. Right? I got the greatest job on the planet. I told you that. Right? I work for the greatest customer. I work for the Army. I get the opportunity to lead a bunch of men and women and give back. So right now, I'm hoping that the brand I'm portraying to you is consistent. I love my job because I love to help the warfighter. I love my job because I get to help the warfighter in a different context. Those are my strengths, right? I want to portray those to you guys because I'm passionate about it, and I give it all to you in the first 2 minutes, right? So what I want you to do is start thinking about this, and it's kind of corny, right? Especially for a lot of you guys that have the real awards, right? But if somebody were to say to you, if you were to receive an award, what would it be for? Sir, what do you think? Come on now. What do you do day in and day out?
I'm a CCNA, CCNP instructor.
All right. So how many students do you teach a year?
Maybe between 60 and
35. Right. You ever had a student come up to you a year later?
Yes.
Right? Like, man, you changed my life, Gene. You helped me fix a moment, you picked a new moment, or I transitioned my career and I really dove into technology. Anything like that happen?
Yes.
Right? Right? So think about this, right? If you were to receive an award now with that launch, what would it be for? Right? So you made a good start. See, I was sitting on home, right? I would say changing the future of the Army Signal Corps. Right? That's a pretty good award. Right? I taught PLDC back when it was still PLDC a long time ago, so our mates know what I'm talking about.
Right.
You younger cats, it's different now, right? And I had a warrant officer come up to me. There's a couple of you guys. Alright?
I attended it, and by the time I graduated, it was WLC.
Okay, there we go.
Yeah, alright.
Nice. So you attended both courses, strong or negative?
Yeah, yeah.
So I had a warrant officer come up to me years later in a mall, and he said, hey, man, you changed what direction I was going. And I think I made one of those off-the-cuff comments, like, you really suck at being a sergeant. You should go be an officer. I'm just kidding, guys. How's that working out, buddy? Right? You're shaping the future of these cats, right? And I must have made one of these off-the-cuff comments, and I do this all the time, right? I say to you, what do you want to do for the rest of your life? If you do any job on the planet, what would it be? I'm going to be disrespectful, right? If I could do any job in the world right now, you know what I would do? I would actually go be a mountain guide. I would love to live outside the rest of my life. I would love to take people into the outdoors, but I'm fat, and I have two kids that need to eat, and that doesn't pay enough for me, right? So if you could do any job on the planet, what job would that be?
I would like to work for Meyer. And okay. And tell the Army about all the different ways that we can do our jobs better.
See, that's a dream job, right? I mean, you know, I'm now in a position of power, right? I'm able to coach and mentor and get back to what I was doing. I probably said to this kid, well, you know, if you want, you can go be a pilot. Why don't you go be a pilot? And then walked off angry. And sure enough, this kid went on to become a pilot, right? As you look at yourself and you think about what kind of awards you want to be, those are award-winning moments, not necessarily for you, but for the people that you've influenced. It's the greatest aspect of the career you guys have chosen over the years, right? Let's be honest. It's not like you set the signal world on fire and have innovated across industry and leapt forward into 2048, right? We're still in the Army Signal community. We're keeping as current as we can. But the reality is the influence and power you guys bring, mentorship and coaching and leadership, that's really where these awards are, right? Don't be ashamed to admit these things and bring these things out as you're talking about it. So what do you do better than anybody else? Sir, in your shirt. What do you do better than anything else? Anybody else?
I'd say that you're a good officer.
Okay, so tell me more.
A lot of the times, maybe it's everyone in this room, but we get a lot of last minute stuff, and
yep.
I pretty much make stuff happen out of nothing.
Yep, working under pressure, mm-hmm. Right? Driving through the problem, breaking it down into its component parts, solving these problems. You don't understand how valuable that is for a civilian hiring manager to hear, right? But if you say, I just want to solve complex problems and you leave it there, that's easy. Right. That's the surface of the ocean. But we all know, especially those of you guys who have served, is that below the surface of the ocean, there's all this other stuff going on that you had to get to get there. And unfortunately, most of the hiring managers that are out there aren't like us and I, right? They have no understanding of what you've done, what you've been through, and all the experiences you've got to make this up. So think about these things that we go through today, if y'all don't mind. Oh, there's one more. Oh, another one. All right. So, we looked at something called an exit statement. All right? I've met a new connection, my LinkedIn buddy, right? And this is what we in sales call the close. Anybody know what the close is? Right? It's where the car dealer, he looks at me and says, so what do I got to do to get you this car today? Right? That's slimy. I get it. But don't kid yourself, it happens every day across all sorts of industries. And as you guys go through these exercises, you are absolutely, absolutely selling yourselves. Right? Make no mistake about it. In that interview, you've got the first couple of minutes to make that good impression and make that guy or gal your best friend. Right? So as we look at this, we're trying to figure out what the situation is and get the summary out there. Hey, really enjoyed my time being in the military. Had a great time. Got to build up some good experiences working in a diverse climate where it was busy one day and then we were planning for long-term over-the-horizon operations the next. I loved working at the strategic level, but I really loved working down in the architectural details, right? I loved building out those plans for over-the-horizon. Where do I want to go? I want to identify these new goals, okay? Now that I've made that transition, sir, I'm going to pick on you again on the MITRE attempt. It's a great one, right? You identify the job you want to go work for, right? Now that I've done all that, I really see the opportunity to work at a federally funded research and development company and to really offer an unbiased opinion on where you guys could go, show you the art of the possible that you all are always too busy to look at in the Army, right? You got to make it positive, right? My wife does this all the time. I love her to death. But man, she leaves with the bad news all the time. Hey, how are things going? Well, my dad's dying. Hey, Debbie Downer, right? Now's not the time for that, right? In this sort of environment, we got to keep it positive. I'm really going to miss a lot of military, but I'm really excited about taking this next step. I'm really looking forward to jumping into this, right? This is a new challenge for me. I know I'm ready for it. The military set me up for it. I've been doing my education, my continuing work. Got a bunch of certifications done as part of all of it. And I'm really looking forward to taking my skills in mentorship and coaching and jumping into that next level. Right? And then I hate to break this to you. You can't wing this. You cannot wing it. You've got to practice it. I had somebody teach me these slides 2 weeks ago. Right? They briefed me on, they presented it to me so I could see what it looked like. And then I practiced it. I was going through the drill sergeant course to memorize all those damn things. I remember practicing it, sitting on the in the thinking room, all right, going over it line by line by line by line by line, over and over and over, before I ever even got to the course. Right? At the end of the day, you've got to practice it. You've got to be able to commit it to memory. Those are critical aspects of this. Because if you cannot hit this very quickly and very succinctly, you're not going to get it. I call this kind of building your own story, though, right? And when I've got an earlier in career, a younger member of my team, I tell them, now's the time where you build your stories out. You build something that you're confident in, relating the stories to people that haven't lived your life, haven't walked in your shoes, that you're trying to convince them to make a change. And this morning, down in my booth, we ran through a rehearsal of the story in our booth, right? And we made some adjustments, and each guy on the team had to rehearse it one time in front of me, and I made some tweaks, and they did it again, and they were smooth, right? So when I get General So-and-so who comes through that booth, and we walk it through, it's not the first time we spit it out, right? We all think we know what we look like when we do this stuff. If you haven't done this, I encourage you to record yourself. Get your kids to record yourself one time. True story, years ago I was in grad school and we were doing this this presentation class, and there were two of us we had to present. And it was sort of pairs. So I would get up and I'd say a bunch of stuff. She would get up and she would say a bunch of stuff. Except every time she stood up, she would go like this as she was walking around the room. She would keep pacing behind, she'd keep putting her hands on her butt, and she'd keep moving her arms up and down. It's the craziest thing I've ever seen. It was a nervous tick, right? I swear to God, it's pretty short. I cannot make this up. So she comes back down, sits down, and the evaluator's giving us some feedback, and I pass her note and I said, please stop touching your backside. Right? She didn't realize what she was doing. She looks at me like a crazy person. Like, that couldn't be possible. I would never do that, right? So I get up, I present my thing, and sit down, and she stands up, and she presents her thing. Sure enough, she's back up there, and as soon as she does it, freezes. She does this. She goes back to present. It was a nervous tick she never realized she'd done. Right? She hadn't grown up in the same environment I had where you got a sergeant major and you were coaching and mentoring young sergeants like Port here. And unfortunately, because she'd never done those things, lo and behold, there she's doing these things. Nobody ever called her on it before. And now all of a sudden she realized she's got that thing. So if you haven't done these statements before, write one out for yourself. But then, once you've written it out, practice it. Make your spouse watch you do it. Get feedback, like real candid feedback. That was fine, honey, is not good enough feedback. Right? Because no matter how tough she or he is on you, I promise you, as a hiring manager, we're going to be tougher. Colonel Franklin and I got an opportunity to sit down with you. You haven't met Colonel Franklin. He's quite in order. We had a great conversation. But he was very self-aware, right? And we had a great conversation about it. Very confident, very well-spoken, but super high energy, right? He knows this. I know I'm super high energy, too, right? As part of our practice, we've got to go through this and realize when we're coming along it's a little too strong, when we're not making our points right. And we only do that through the practice, through the rhythm and all that. Does that make sense? I mean, I know it sounds crazy, like I got to tell you all this, especially with my instructors in the room, but all right, so we talked about kind of how we're wrapping up the meeting. Well, let's talk a little bit about how you're going to get that first meeting, how you're going to build out that brand. This is what we call the professional value proposition. All right, it's a simple message. Who am I? Why do you want to talk to me? Why am I important to your business? The elevator pitch. You got 30 seconds with somebody in the hallway down here? All right, I've met General Ray a couple of times now. I assure you that when I walk up to him, I have thought through in my head exactly what I'm going to say. That man is much bigger than me, and I do not want to piss him off. All right? But the reality here is, if I've got 30 seconds to make that impact, I've got to take my shot every single time as a sales guy, right? And you all, as selling yourselves, I need you all to take that shot too. It's how you build out that network. All right, I think I've... So now, as we think about this, as you look at your brand as a statement, this goes back to a little bit about what we talked about a few minutes ago, right? What are those criteria about you that make you unique, make you special? What I will say is there are certain buzzwords that, when I hear them, they're sort of trigger words for me where I've got to dig deeper. Somebody says they are a strategic thinker. Okay? What does that mean? I've been at Cisco 5 years. We use the term strategic all the time. 10% of us use it correctly. Right? I'm strategic. No, you're not. What does that mean? Tell me what that means. Right? There are other buzzwords that you hear and you immediately start thinking, this is somebody that has sort of stopped working. Right? Or this is somebody that really doesn't know what they really want to do, so I've got to drive deeper. What I want you all to look at is, think about those skills and attributes that you are doing right now that you've done in your career that are going to resonate out there and translate that military experience into words that hiring managers are able to adapt to. I saw a posting on an infantry message board, right? I love these guys. My brother Crown here is killing me. Kid says, I'm going in to interview with TSA for a job at the airport, right? Not a bad career field for a young guy who's done 5 years in the industry and is now throwing bottles in the back and looking for a new job change. And he says, I want to wear my flag and my CIV. And I said, brother, with much respect, that flag thing is okay. You're going to TSA, they're all paid by the federal government. That CIV, that's dangerous waters you're working in. Think about that. Here I am, a brother, your guy, and I got to tell him, well, I don't know about that. I got a lot of respect for it. But that guy or gal sitting across from you, you don't know how they're going to perceive it. Do they know what it means? What are the connotations they have? My battle buddy from basic training 30 years ago, God, that feels a lot closer than that. Chuck Poole, I'll never forget him, kid out of Maine, nice kid on the planet, absolutely the worst soldier ever. I think he went on to go work for the state police in Maine. Now, I guarantee you, when Chuck pulls over a soldier today, he's getting a ticket, right? That kid is, that driver is getting a ticket because Chuck has got a distaste for the military after they put him out in basic training. Chuck was a crappy soldier. He was the worst, right? He was 1 degree away from Private Pop, just a total train wreck. But now, he is the most bitter anti-military guy there could be, right? So you roll in there with that CIV and you get somebody across the table from you, and they go, what is, you were one of those guys, huh? Got it. So as you try and translate these military experiences over to the civilian sector, it's important that you start using their vernacular, their jargon, their words, right? You translate those skills that you've built out. Chief, your example around being an instructor is spot on, right? Everybody gets a good teacher, right? Everybody gets a good coach, mentor. And now as, former NCO, I get the honor of teaching younger guys coming in to my team how to be better account manager, how to be better service for our customer. Right? Those skills translate. Operating JNN stack. Unless you were talking about operating that stack or a contractor that built that stack, doesn't mean a whole lot. Now, operating satellite arrays, tying in enterprise network communications, go work for Fox News. Operating JNN stack, go out and be a contractor back in the desert. You see what I'm saying there? It's all making sense. And I'm sure some of you guys have heard this from the TAP folks as well. How are we doing on time? All right. So the four key components are pretty straightforward. And we've got these in a handout, so don't feel like you got to take down copious notes. All right. And again, my name is Jason Port, P-O-R-T. So if you do write down anything, I'll have cards up here and all that. Please connect with me on LinkedIn. We can share all this with you digitally. So, what is your professional and general background overview, right? Who am I? I'm Jason Port. I work for Cisco Systems, right? What do you do that creates value and makes an impact? What are your strengths? Again, this is why we kind of walked through some of these exercises earlier today, right? I won't belabor the point here. Hope you get what I'm saying here.
So,
What other evidence do you have that demonstrates these strengths, right? You need tangible metrics. Chief is why I asked about how many students you teach, right? Is that easy? Sergeant Major, how many people are in your time, Sergeant Major, brigade? I'm sorry?
I'm staff.
Your staff, sorry.
I work with these guys.
Oh, fantastic.
Great job.
All right, so how many folks are in your sphere of influence, though, right now?
Hundreds.
Hundreds, really. Right? So this shows a massive scale, right? That in my world, at most, I deal with 60 people. Even my bosses above me have smaller spheres of influence. Think about how much impact you've got on the grand scale. It's enormous, right? Where's my network engineers at? They do base comms or network comms here. Nobody? Nobody's doing base comms here? All right. So, I mean, if you think about as a service provider, how many folks are touched by the services you provide? These are real tangible metrics, all right? And these are the sorts of things that you want to bring out very quickly, what the high point is. 3,000 men and women that are veterans at Cisco and their spouses, one of the sentences I used earlier, right? I guarantee you some of you like 3,000 veterans at Cisco, that's a lot of people. That's a lot of people, right? But that's why I dropped those numbers. It's not because I don't care about it. That's a very specific number. And then what are you excited about doing in your next role? Again, if you show up and say, I'm strategic and I'm looking to do strategic things, you and I won't be friends, right? But if you show up and you say, I want to shape large teams and achieve really big outcomes because I get excited about seeing big project success. That's pretty cool, seeing somebody gets excited about that stuff still. Because again, if they're hiring you, there's a good chance that the people on their team right now have hit lethargy or inertia, right? They're bored. They've been doing the same job for so long. They need fresh blood. They need new excitement. And so in turn, while you all might not believe it, when I see somebody coming out of the military, we call you all early in career. Why? It's easy. Because you all are coming out of one career and moving into another career, which means you bring new energy. You bring new experiences that we don't have right now. And the craziest part is that you all, as early in career folks, get lumped in with my 22-year-old college graduates. Because they are coming in with that same amount of experience, same amount of excitement about these new jobs, these new opportunities. And when I took my job as a sales manager, I had a couple of folks that had been a little longer in career. It's harder to get those guys excited about jobs, right? And if you've got an E5 that's been in that same job for 36 months, right? You're like, oh, dude, this poor guy. I got to get him out. He's just bored, right? We have the same problem on the civilian side. And so as you guys look at this, help your hiring manager get excited about what they're going to be doing in their next career. Or what you're going to be doing in your next career. I'm sorry. The flashing lights caused internal chaos. All right. So here's a couple of examples. I won't read them to you. I'm going to give you a minute just so you can get a feel for what we're talking about here, though. I'm just going to stand up here and smile and look really amazing and pretty for this gentleman with the camera. Thank you, sir. That's going to be what do they call it? There you go. See, has a diverse language skill set and rapid ability to solve through very complex problems at a moment's notice. See, I just wrote professional. Absolutely. All right. So who am I? I'm an operations manager. I've got really great talent management. I always keep my facilities operating within or below budget standards. Right. I mean, if these things aren't sort of resonating with your day-to-day career or seeing the translation, please see me after this, and I will help you make a translation. Because I promise you, the stuff that you all do on a day-to-day basis or that you've done throughout your careers, it is far more impactful than some dude that has only done this in the civilian sector, right? So, I'm going to skip that one. All right, so as you look at your summary statement, right? Start building out your resume. This is the natural extension. You got your quick hit. This is who I am, what I'm all about. As you start building out your resume, start looking at tangible metrics again. Put this into a narrative form. Get this onto your resume. These buzzwords count, especially in the modern day environment where you're throwing your resume into a database. Okay? So start thinking about these things as well. I'm going to skip through some of this. Oh, I thought I had this one. I didn't like this much. You're up right up there, so that's fine. All right. So as you look at your components of a summary statement, right, tell me about how long you've been in the business. Tell me about what your track record looks like. Tell me about where your skills are in building. Now, to be honest with you, that first one makes me a little nervous. I've got 30 years in industry, 50 years old almost this winter. I know, incredibly handsome, you look very youthful. It's all the neck fat, keep me young. All right, I appreciate being, for you gentlemen in my age bracket, I'll say, being a little reticent about putting in, I've been in this industry for 29 years, I wouldn't put in that, right? What I would say as a sales manager for the past 2 years, or as a manager for the past 10 years, or I box it a little bit. I would definitely box it around the position I want to have, not exactly around who I am or what I've done. Does that make sense? Right? If you've got 25 years as an IT specialist or an IT worker, right? But 10 years of it is as a IT manager, you want to make that jump into an IT manager position, you have 10 years as a manager, right? Because I ain't going to lie, there's some shady cats out there that will look at that and be like, 29 years in the industry, that's too expensive, too old, been around too long. Whatever, right? Play the game. But the rest of it, though, it's all there, right? Especially the track record of your accomplishments. Numbers count. People are drawn to the numbers as they read your stuff. And definitely make sure that you can pull some of that stuff together. And then wrap it all up with examples of those roles and then where you specifically are excelling, right? Again, we're leaving them on that positive note to close. This is the dude or dudette that I'm hiring into my organization. All right. Brother Gus, I think you're up, right? Or are you right after this one? I think he's faking. I think Gus has got me doing this whole thing. All right. So now, as you get down into your resume, it is time to start listing your accomplishments. I will share with you guys a couple months ago, Greg, I'm going to pick on you. Greg, what's your brother do now in the Army?
He just
came out. Coming to command, come on, though. Doing what?
He was HEC commander, second.
Okay. All right. His resume was probably a net total of maybe 20 lines of text as I read through it, right? Very focused on the accomplishments. Gone are the days of huge blocks of text. If you write up a paragraph of text, I've stopped reading before I get to the dates. One, I've just got a lot of resumes coming across my desk. And two, and more importantly, I really want the highlights. Because we're going to talk if I like the highlights. And I loved his resume. I didn't know it was your brother. I read through it, and within a few minutes, I was on the phone with the guy. All right? So, concise. You did a tremendous job. I don't know if you helped him wrote it for him. He did, didn't you? Got him, right? You probably got a copy in crayon. It was literally for each position in the Army that he had, it was two or three sentences. And it really wrapped up everything he'd done. Chief, again, I'll pick on you if you don't mind, right? Train 200 students every 26 weeks, right? Or whatever it is, right, would be one of those things that I did. Developed a program of instruction to ensure that we're remaining on track with doctrinal guidance or in terms of educational objectives, right?
That's it. That's what
I got to say. If I'm looking for an instructor, you're my dude, right? Now, the next one down, whatever that last career was that you did, that last job choice you had, maybe that's the one that I want to hit. But I want those two bullets that really convey to me what your big things for, where you deserve the awards, right? If you guys can get that across in the scope and show me those results, and then tell me about the awards that you won. Now, this is kind of tricky again. I got a pile of Army Achievement Medals, right? Nobody on the civilian sector knows what that's about, right? Order of St. Barbara.
Mercury, Bronze Order, Mercury, Silver Order, Mercury, Gold Order, Mercury, for the single post, right?
You get the Order of Mercury. That's pretty badass, in my opinion, because I got the St. George from the armor program, right? Awesome, right? That was, for me, it was a big award for me. On the other hand, try and translate that into the civilian sector. And for you guys in the single community, you can do it, right? In my case, it is recognition amongst the top leaders, amongst 1,000 people, right? That's really what it is. We've got about 1,000 people in the squadron, right? I was recognized as being a stud, and they gave me this cool, called my bobsledding medal, right? And it's awesome. But by doing that, it translates into the civilian sector, especially what you all do in the single community. There's a direct correlation being recognized at that level, right? It is a national award, right? Or international award, really. You put it in context, especially if you write your resume, it's definitely an international award, right? So make sure you get those things noted out there as you're going through all these things. Any sort of cost savings, especially the IT folks in the room. The work I did saved us $14 million a year. Whatever that is, get those things on the paper, right? Any questions about this part of it here? Good to go? All right, now, please tell me.
Smart storage.
Yes.
Get to the smart storage.
Oh, yes, sir.
It's the question slide, right?
There we go.
Bill Belbass.
Yes, sir.
So, good afternoon. My name is Gus Mendiola. As Jason mentioned, I'm the insurance manager on his team, so I support his team of 11 account managers. I have 9 systems engineers, and we really, really love our company. It's extremely popular. I'm going to talk about story. Before I talk about story, the first thing I want to tell you is that in your transition, you are not alone. At times you feel that you are, but you are good enough. Just like now, you're senior warrant officer, teaching other warrant officers. What it is how to be a warrant officer, the same thing. There are fellow veterans around you that will help you with this process. You just have to be willing to reach out and accept that assistance. So you're not lonely. That's what we did with when it comes to telling stories, one thing that I've acknowledged from this is that I get volunteer with a program called Primary Heroes. And I get signed up, and he's a 6 month volunteer to talk about his person. We're trying to match him up based on their interests and skill sets. And so often I get senior leaders that want to transition. This is the part that I like to talk about, is developing their stories. You've got a story that you like your resume is a story about you, and a very concise story. You're trying to wrap up all the things that you've done in your career, all your accolades, all your highlights, that's your resume, that's the one that you write down. But there's a lot more to that story that you have to be thinking about and developing yourself. Like I just talked about, practicing that story, practice that or rehearse that story to yourself. What do these stories consist of, right? So I'm not going to read the slides to you. This is an acronym that gives you guys on how to develop stories. You guys are all going to tell stories, right? We're all in the Army, right? You're in the bus coming back from airborne operation. And what do? You tell stories about jumps. The last jump was the best one or whatever, right? You're in the field, you sit down, and you start telling war stories. Okay? It's the same thing. All you're doing is you're reading the person that you're either interviewing with, that you're trying to sell yourself to. You want to bring them into your environment. The best way we do that as humans, what do? We tell each other stories. So this is what you're doing. You're building a story, and you're bringing them into your environment. Right? You're now going to tell them about you, why you are the best person for the job that you are seeking or the thing that company needs, which is why you're an awesome human being. Okay? So you want to tell a story and bring your audience, right? Whether it be an audience, a panel, a hybrid panel, and you're going to be multiple people or individual people, and bring them into that story. And you start telling them about the things that you do. Right? You want to be concise. But what you're doing is you're buying yourself some time to think about what you're going to say next, right? Because you want to tailor the message to the person that is asking the question, don't you? So you can ask a question that says, what did you receive that in your resume you received your Army Achievement Medal? And you're like, okay, how about this? And the person I was the chief warrant officer at QID. There we were, just south of UMC, right? This is something that you're telling. You're bringing the person into the story that you're telling. Why are you doing this? Because in your mind, you're trying to remember that which one of the six awards am I going to talk about? Right? The truth of it is, does the story need to be a true story?
10% true. 10% will.
Exactly right. Never let this
smart. My team is laughing like that. I use that term all the time.
You bring it, this is your story, right? And so I tell people often, you don't have to do just one thing. You can combine elements from various stories that make up this narrative that you're telling. So the entire time, what are you doing? You're making time for you to think about how you're going to actually answer the question that you're being asked. Right? So you're setting, and this is why you got to practice it, because as you're telling the setup to the story, your brain has got to be automatic. You're telling the story while you're thinking about how I'm going to answer the question, and more importantly, relate the things in the story that you want to answer in the question. Right? So pulling up the things of, why did you take that action that you took during this story? Why did it matter to this particular employer or person? As you're tying those things, what are the buzzwords that you're trying to use to relate the elements of your story back to the person that you're telling the story? This is why you're not the person. The setup has got to be natural, rehearsed, you're telling the story, and at the whole time you're thinking about how you're going to answer the question. Okay? Again, the story doesn't have to be true, and it doesn't have to be your own story, right? People have friends that have kids that have done some borrow somebody else's story and become your story. If you care, or you've heard a story enough, then it's your story. Right? Unless the person you're entering them with was with you, you're not going to make any difference now. No one is advocating that he lied. That's all I was saying. You're trying to set yourself up to be able to answer these questions on how to relate the information about you back to the person that is doing these interviews for you. Now, this system up here that we've got these slides, which we, as a matter of fact, I have a story about this. Would you mind grabbing the handouts that are in the people? We have a handout, so you don't have to write down the notes from small stories and certain things that you can take a look at. This will help you start to develop what this story is. As part of this storytelling, you have to determine who your target audience is. Is the person I'm talking to, are they in the service or not? Are they service friendly, just like Jason was talking about in the example of the CID, are they service friendly? This is also tailor how you can tell this particular story. You start with a situation, right? How all stories start? No shit. Here I was.
See what had happened was.
Right? Exactly. So you start off, you start to bring the audience into your story. Right? And the entire time you're setting up, and you start to say, and this is why what I did is important to your company. This is why I will be successful in doing the things that you need to do. The things that you talk about in your story all need to be positive things. What do you think? No.
You learn. Show how you
learn. Exactly. Right? You can show some vulnerability that I did this and I learned from it. Right? I learned from it. But let me tell you the next, let me continue the story. And the next time I was in that situation, here is what I did. And that's how I learned from that story. Right? So not only are you, hey, I'm a person that's learning, and I took those things in practice and the story. Okay? So then you're pulling all your experiences. It doesn't have to be you've got assigned, but of course the career, you've got like 10 units at least. Right? At least, right? The story, it doesn't matter. Pick a unit, pick your favorite story, and mix all the elements together of your story. story into one cohesive story or person, and then you'll draw from your experiences from there. What's nice about that is that it takes away the nervousness, right? So if you're in the middle of an interview, say, you're a little nervous and somebody asks you a question, hey, one of the questions that I always have to ask is, tell me about a time where you had conflicts with either a peer or with a superior. And what did you learn from it, and how did you do something different?
I learned you can't punch me in the throat.
Yeah. And when I punched you in the throat, you called the MPs, and here's what happened. But I learned from that. And here's what I did the next time. You follow me, sir? So, you set it up. So,
the person's saying, even here, they're saying, developing stories, trying to understand. Questions the same. Stories, and they come up with some questions and answer and the story.
Yes.
I'm trying to understand.
Yeah.
It's like getting stories.
Right.
Answer what?
Yeah, so
you make up some questions that you think can be.
Yes, you can do that. Yeah, so typically when I'm talking to folks about story pieces, when you're preparing for so typically you take the hiring requisition, right? That describes all the things that the company or that the hiring manager wants you to be able to do. Right? So a lot of people say, take a look at that. Look at all those things, highlight all the key words. And now these are the elements that I have to take in my story, and I have to target those particular elements. The basis of my story is the same.
Yeah.
There I was, paratrooper, 82nd Airborne.
Here we go again.
RC South, Cannonball, I was talking about that. No shit, there I was. He's one of the logistics. Well, I was friends with the G4. And then here's the things that we did, so typically, but it's also remember, every conversation that you're having with somebody that's moving forward is potentially neutral. Okay? You're being evaluated all the time. And so you've got this opportunity to be experienced to help you create and collect your thoughts. All about what you're doing, share your experiences, and trust me, you guys like to tell stories. I know I like to tell stories too. You get super excited about it, and that excitement comes out like you do again. You're genuinely excited about what you did and how the things that you did will help you do the things that now you want to do comes out. That's just why I'm the story. So, there's more slides I think in here about telling the story. Right, so again, you're also telling the story as part of your resume. On your resume, you don't need to be as detailed. You don't have a lot of space. Things have to be concise, but you do want to tell the story. One thing about the resume that I found, and it's bothered me the last couple of resumes that I've seen. You get advice that says, make sure you put the language in your resume to make sure that civilians will understand what it is they understand. You can go too far in the other direction. Meaning, I read CW4's resume. I don't know what brings this talking to better. I had no idea that the person was serving them. Okay? So I was like, right. So it's possible to go way too far down the other spectrum and not be progressive, right? So again, you need to obviously you're trying to balance, right? You're going to you're trying to get a job in green fields or something like that, you know, maybe you want to do that. Most of the time if you travel what you've done, it matters. Okay? It matters to people. And be proud of it. Why did you get your last part out? Tell the story, Chief. Tell the story. There I was in front of my class. I had 60 students that were all trying to take the CCMP. And the 60 students that took the CCMP, 59 of them passed. And that's why I got the part. Do you want to know the difference? right? So again, you can go too far in one direction when it comes to your resume, when it comes to your story. The same thing when you're telling the story, and you become excited and get to tell a lot of details. Again, you've got to listen to the feedback from the person that you're talking to and see what time. Are they digging the story or are they not digging the story? If they're not digging the story, you've got to back off and get into the story. Okay? Yet you don't, you've got to practice this. You've got to practice it with each other, you've got to practice it with other folks. There's resources for you to practice this stuff. Again, my name is Gus Mendiola. You can find me on LinkedIn as well. If you want to practice your story, call me up. I'll ask a bunch of questions and practice your story. Simply just be one of us. You can practice your story.
That's better. You're good.
I'm sorry?
You're good.
How much more time do we have?
I don't know. How much more time do you have? Much better.
So as we kind of run the session, you have about 10 minutes.
Thank you, sir. Appreciate it. So we'll wrap it up. I think as we close out, I hope this has been of some benefit here, because I know that you're getting a lot of this stuff through the TAP programs. What I will say is, as the recipient of some of the stuff that's come from the TAP programs, sometimes they hit the mark, sometimes they don't. We do these sorts of trainings all over the country. This is our first time doing it at AFCEA Tech, and so I really do appreciate you guys coming in and sitting down with us. I want to stress with these smart stories, Gus and I did an offsite with our 60-person team about a year and a half ago, right? And we spent most of our time, believe it or not, talking about these stories. Not in the context of job searching, although one of them was. All right, but in the context of how we build our portfolio out. And all day, every day, Gus and I and my partners and Brian out there, we go in and we talk to places, and we tell the stories that we've got. All right, hey, this is what we saw happen out of the Idaho Army National Guard. But this is what we saw happen out of Second Striker Cav about 3 years ago. And where they could be doing better, right? This is what we saw over here. And these are areas where we could help you all improve it. To Gus's point, as you build out these stories, have a couple of them, all right? Every one of you guys has an incredible story. As a hiring manager, I certainly have got a soft spot in my heart for the men and women that are coming out of the military. I get it. But to be truthful, I'm not alone, right? Even though I wore a uniform for a little while in my life, more and more Americans are out there looking for people that are just like you guys, that are coming in with these great stories. And they still get giddy, and they still say thank you for your service when you walk up, you know, they walk up to you early. This is a great time to be an American, especially a man or woman who's done time in the military to serve their country. There's a lot of people out there that want to help you. And candidly, those that don't want to help you, when you tell them the story about your service, and they look at you funny, you didn't want to work with them anyway. The most important piece of advice I've ever gotten in my entire life, in my career, swear to God, is that you work for people, not for companies. I like working for Cisco. I love working for my boss. And when I first came on board Cisco, it was between Cisco and another major company who does a lot of IT work, again, for the Army. And when I talked to the boss at Cisco, when I talked to the boss at the other company, I went back and forth 8 or 9 times. I'm not kidding you. They both wanted me. I thought that was a pretty strong prompt. But the reality is, every time I talked to those other cats, they were offering a ton more money. Every time I came back to Cisco, I talked to this cat named Mike. Mike treated me with dignity and respect. He listened to my war stories. He talked to me about all the great stuff I was going to be able to do working for him, the autonomy I was going to have. And the other guys kept talking about the money. The money's there. Oh my God, you make $700,000. It's going to be incredible. Mike, you're my guy. To the point where I got angry phone calls from the other company that they lost, right? I went on to do 3 years here at Cisco with the Air Force team, working for Mike, went on to make a good amount of money, was very happy during my 3 years there. I've gone on to become a manager here at Cisco. I work with a great bunch of Americans that do great things for you guys every day. It's the people that I work for. I'm glad I was able to tell those smart stories. I'm glad I was able to get in front of the right people and make this happen. Tomorrow morning, if you dare, after me and my colleagues, and I hope many of you will join us at these happy hours this evening, I plan on rolling in here at 7 a.m., and we're going to have a panel of 5 vets up here that have made these transitions happen. They've actually gone through their own journeys, and these are not retired general officers, right? I love those guys. I can get a job as a retired general officer by walking into the bar downstairs at the Marriott, right? If I'm the CW5 in the Army, I can walk into any restaurant and get a job. If I'm the chief of naval operations, I'll never want to work. The reality is, at least from what I can tell in this audience, you all ain't it, and you know the guys are going to be up on this panel tomorrow. Right? Sorry. Please don't put the shatter in your ego. Right? Try and control yourself. It's going to be okay. You're not a general. The reality is you're going to have to work like the rest of us. All right? But the reality is you're going to have five folks up here, some of whom are here represented today. They left the military at 85, 86. Got one sergeant major coming in tomorrow. Got CW3, right? CW4, Gus? Four, right? Guys that came off the line doing day in and day out great work and are now and made that transition. Each one of these guys has got a unique story. Nobody's got an easy story, right? And they're all now working for Cisco or other industry partners. So if you dare, come on out. We have some breakfast for you guys tomorrow morning. Hopefully we can share some more stories with you at the end of our day with us. Hope to see you guys out at this happy hour tonight. And then on Thursday, we'll be back out here doing another session, 2 to 4, I believe, where we'll be talking a little bit more about the interview process and how not to pick your nose in the middle of the interview. I remember to sit and fly up. I do that all the time. I'm not going to lie. Fly down and took a job. Right? My point is, though, that session will only be an hour because I got to catch a flight out of Charlotte that afternoon. But, again, I really thank Gus Mendiola for being here with me today and presenting. We will be around for questions. If there's questions, y'all want to shout them out while we're waiting. I know some of y'all have got time hacks you've got to get to. But I really appreciate y'all spending time with us this afternoon. I hope this was helpful. And, again, my name is Jason Port. I'm in Baltimore, Maryland. If I don't get a LinkedIn request from you with an email, a message that tells me about who you are and what you want to be when you make this transition happen, I'm going to be disappointed. And my feelings are very sensitive. I want you to know that. I'm a little teary guy. But in all seriousness, I want to hear from you guys. I want to hear from your friends, your soldiers that are looking to make that transition. I will end with, I have 3,000 men and women in Cisco that want to help you make this journey happen. We have a strong mentorship program, like Gus said. We are here to help you guys. Lean on us. That's all I got for today. So what questions can I answer for y'all? Yes, sir.
Are these slides on the conference website?
The slides are not on the conference website. We're not posting them up there, but if you reach out to me, I will be happy to get you a copy of them. If you got a pencil and paper, my email address, and I'm happy to give you a card too, is jhsport, like soccer, football, jhsport@cisco.com. Or if you're German, it's joshsport@cisco.com. Not so much. But you can email me. I'll be glad to get you a copy of the slides, get you a copy of the handouts. You can take them with you. Rysmore gets a little pissy if you try and present them without me. They let us use them, but I think they did a pretty good job. You also, you got your feedback on them when we presented today. I'd love to hear it just one-on-one. This is our first time using these here. And I feel like they were pretty good. I got some ideas, but I'd love to hear your feedback on them. Good to go. Yes, sir.
Say again where your panel is in the morning.
It'll be right back in here. Yep, yep. And there will be breakfast served, free coffee, some waters, and some pastries and all that. And more coffee. So, thanks. It's commitment. Any other questions this evening? All right, well, listen, there's two great happy hours this evening. I hope to see you all there. They're sponsored by a couple of our partners. I won't publicize who they are, but if you can't figure it out, come see them. Get you there. You will see me out there, and again, Jason Ford, come on up and introduce yourself. Tell me about your story. I'd love to hear it. Thank you all for coming out today. Have a great afternoon. My point is, I'm guys are coming.
I'm going to check it again.
I told you I'm going to
repeat
that one. Before that, let me just do that. You good guy. You didn't say that.
The worst conversation you ever
had. I'll walk into your house and see you. Walk out.
Mm-hmm. So why
turn mine just finishes up.